keep your place in Hebrews, but why don't we turn to Isaiah chapter 1. The book of Isaiah chapter 1. Now while you're turning there, just to set the stage, if you're familiar with the book of Isaiah, you start reading this book and it's like turning on the fire hose. I mean, Isaiah just jumps right into it with both barrels blazing. And God, speaking through the prophet Isaiah, is rebuking the nation of Israel for her sins. And the reference there to the donkey or the ox, two animals that aren't exactly known for their intelligence, just brute beasts of burden, and yet says, these animals are smart enough to know who their master is, who feeds them, who's their owner, and yet my own people don't even know. They don't even understand. He goes on to rebuke them for their sins. And then goes on to explain that, and I've been trying to correct them. I've been trying to like wake them up, to get them to repent. And they've been suffering, and yet it's not doing any good. In fact, if I hadn't shown a little bit of mercy, they would have been completely destroyed like Sodom and Gomorrah. And so that's where we're going to pick it up at verse 10 of chapter 1. He's addressing the leaders of the nation, but he's comparing them to the leaders of Sodom and Gomorrah, who of course had been destroyed centuries before. Verse 10, chapter 1. Hear the word of the Lord, you rulers of Sodom. Give ear to the law of our God, you people of Gomorrah. To what purpose is the multitude of your sacrifices to me, says the Lord? I've had enough of burnt offerings of rams and the fat of fed cattle. I do not delight in the blood of bulls or of lambs or goats. When you come to appear before me, who has required this from your hand to trample my courts? Bring no more futile sacrifices. Incense is an abomination to me. The new moons, the Sabbaths, and the calling of assemblies, I cannot endure iniquity in the sacred meeting. Your new moons and your appointed feasts, my soul hates. They are a trouble to me. I am weary of bearing them. When you spread out your hand, speaking of prayer, I will hide my eyes from you. Even though you make many prayers, I will not hear. Your hands are full of blood. And then he goes on to call them to repentance, to call them to having their sins forgiven. That's the idea. You see, when Isaiah was saying those words on behalf of the Lord, the temple was standing. The people were offering their sacrifices like they were supposed to. And that's why God is so furious. Because they thought, hey, as long as we bring our sacrifices, it's cool. We can live any way we want. And God says, I don't care about these sacrifices. I don't care about the blood of bulls and goats. Later, through the prophet Joel, the Lord would say, rend your heart and not your garments. The tearing of the garments was the outward visible act of a Jew to show how mournful and sorry and, oh, it's so horrible. And they would tear, and everyone would get to see it, of course. Oh, wow, boy, that guy. And God is saying, it's your heart that matters, not the outward visible religious formality. And I think that there's definitely a comparison that we could make to the church age today. Someone says, hey, I go to church every Sunday. I never miss a Sunday. And when the offering comes around, I always make sure to put something in it. God says, who cares if your heart is not right? If it's just about outward religious formality, it means nothing. Being a Christian is not about going to church on Sunday. Being a Christian is about a relationship with the living Savior, the Lord of all creation, who died for you, who rose from the dead, and has ascended into the heavens, and whom we worship. And as an act of worship, we do come to church on Sunday, and we do give in the offering, and we do these things, but it's about our heart. That's what God sees, that's what he looks upon, that's what he cares about. And if you have trusted in Jesus Christ as your Savior and have been born again, the Bible says that you are in the process of being transformed into the image of Jesus Christ. And it's the same word, image, that we mentioned earlier. The likeness of Christ by the power of the Holy Spirit who dwells within you. That's Christianity. Now, the next contrast has to do with the will of God. And here again, the will of God under that old Mosaic law and the will of God as seen, understood through Jesus. So we're at verse 7, still in the middle of this psalm, and still again, read this from the perspective of Jesus saying the words prophetically. Verse 7, Hebrews 10, "Then I said, behold, I have come." And then a little parenthesis, "in the volume or in the scroll of the book, it is written of me to do your will, O God." Previously saying, "sacrifice and offering, burnt offerings and offerings for sin you did not desire, nor had pleasure in them, which are offered according to the law." Then he said, "Behold, I've come to do your will, O God." He takes away the first that he may establish the second. By that will, we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once for all. So there you see the contrast. Again, God gives his law through Moses. "These are my commands. This is my will for you." And it involved all those animal sacrifices and everything else. But of course, mankind fails in keeping obedience to the law. And God doesn't care about the outward formality of just the animal sacrifices. And so the real will of God is seen in Jesus Christ, and it begins all the way back to the incarnation itself, to even becoming a man, a body you've prepared for me. I've come, he's come to this earth, to do your will, O God, to do the will of the Father. The little parenthesis there, "in the volume or in the scroll of the book, it is written of me." For a long time, I only saw that verse in connection with the fulfilled prophecies of Jesus. In his birth, his life, his death, his resurrection, all those Old Testament prophecies about Jesus. I say, oh yeah, the Bible's filled with them, the volume of the book. But it's much deeper than just simply that. Our writer to Hebrews did not include it, but if we were in Psalm 40 and we were to continue reading from where the quote leaves off here, the very next words we would read after "to do your will, O God," would be, "and your law is within my heart." Again, from the reference of Jesus. Jesus said, "Don't think I came to destroy the law and the prophets. I came to fulfill them." The law and the prophets was an expression used not just by Jesus, but by others in the New Testament to refer to the entire Old Testament. It was a way of describing the Old Testament, the law and the prophets. So what Jesus is saying is, I came to fulfill the entire Old Testament. Not just all of the prophecies that he fulfilled in his life and all, but he fulfilled every command, every detail, every regulation of God's law. And he did so voluntarily, and it was his delight to do so, even though it would lead to the cross. And so, he offers himself, his body, once as the perfect, sinless offering for sin.